city. We of course pulled him out before he got busy in the conference. Surendra, thank you very much. Surendra has already made a sensational beginning to the Citi India Investor Conference by upping the census target for FY18 to 32,200. Their initial target was 31,500. Surendra, that's a great start to the conference, but why? Why the upgrade?
Okay, so first of all, thanks for having me on the show. In terms of this upgrade, so we were kind of taking stock of fourth quarter earnings, okay, and earnings have kind of come in slightly ahead of estimates. We were looking at BSE 100 expectations. They're around 2% higher than what the expectations were. So this change in the target is more of a roll forward. So our earlier target was a December 17 target. We have rolled it forward to March 18, and which is what kind of leads to the change from 31,500 to 32,200.
Correct. Surendra, while you've rolled over to 32,200 levels, still it doesn't mean a lot of upside from current levels. You know, maybe a 5% upside for the next, say, 8 to 9 months. In that sense, do you think most of the good news is priced in? And from an earnings point of view, do you think FY18 will be a bit of downgrade?
Okay. So the way I would look at it is that, see, it's a very interesting market, okay? So firstly, on one side, you have the macro argument, low inflation, GST coming soon, about to come in. That remains strong. Domestic flows have been very strong for the last 24 months. FI flows also have been reasonably strong. So you have this positives on one hand, and which is what gives people a medium-term comfort that, yeah, India is one of the key markets to be in. But at the same time, I don't think we can ignore the fact that earnings revisions are still downward. So our analysts were expecting around 17-18% growth in FY18, start of the year. That number is now down to closer to 15%. So earnings are still getting downgraded for FY18. At the same time, valuations are at 18 times 1 year forward, or FY18, which is more than one standard deviation above the 10-year mean. Okay, so I think, again, if you look at some other factors, mid-cap valuations are significantly higher than large caps. Okay, so I think when you put it all together, to me what it seems like, yes, the medium-term positives are all there, okay, but we have had a 21% return, YTD in dollar terms, which is a fantastic return by any standards. And to that extent, I think one should be more stock-specific and buy the pullbacks, rather than really chasing the market here. At least that's the way I would look at it, and which is what reflects in our census target, which, as you rightly pointed out, only has some 3-4% upside from current levels.
Okay.
I'll ask you about your sector preferences and the mid-cap picks and whatever. What on the FI sentiment? I believe there are a lot of FIs joining at the conference over the next 2 days. What's the general sense? Is this India being the best market within the EM, which probably means India will continue to outperform?
Yeah. So I think as you see over the day, next couple of days, I think you will see that the interest, the participation remains very high. Okay. And to that extent, when we go out and meet clients, interest in India is very high. And we have seen this really shift in the last 5 months. So in November, December, people did turn negative. Okay, what was reflected in the FII numbers as well, the selling as well. And then January, as the earnings started coming out, and then some of the companies came and said, oh, things are not looking so bad, etc., etc., we started seeing interest building up. And then again, Feb and March were very strong months. Okay, so my sense is that yes, people did sell out, but then people got back in. And given the kind of returns we are seeing, definitely the interest is very high. And see, when I meet a lot of emerging market funds, okay, they have some kind of a framework to evaluate market attractiveness. Okay, and parameters may be a little different, but everybody will look at GDP growth, yeah, earnings outlook, central government, or the government, what it's doing, the central bank, currency, there are like multiple things which go into it. But whichever framework you look at and you kind of start plugging in, India will always appear as one of the best markets to be. And which is the reason I think it will remain a very high interest market. I always meet clients who think, yeah, the market in the short term has maybe outdone itself, maybe it's on the higher side, waiting for a pullback. Okay, but interest-wise, they're always interested, and I think even those guys are all kind of waiting to buy a pullback.
Okay, buy the pullback, okay. You don't have much of an upside from here on, but what are you recommending? I mean, are you recommending the now, suddenly discovered valuation sector, pharma?
Yeah, okay, so to that extent, yes, we do have a overweight on healthcare, but to put it in context, our healthcare is our overweight on healthcare is a mix of overweight on hospitals as well as mid-cap pharma. Okay, so those are the two pockets of pharma where we are overweight on. See, the sector is clearly seeing challenges from a pricing erosion of the base business perspective.
So you will not be buying the nifty pharma company?
The large cap pharma stocks.
Again, I really don't want to go very stock specific, okay, but as I said that, see, the way to look at it, at least in my view, is that companies which have a large base business and maybe a few chunky products in that, will face more challenges of price erosion and which some of the new products may not be able to offset. While in some of the smaller companies, and again, pharma is very stock specific, so it's difficult to talk like generically, but the issue is some of the smaller companies may be able to offset those challenges a lot better.
Okay. And the other sector I want to ask you, obviously, is financials. We just had Samiran saying that he's factoring in a 40% chance of a rate cut. Be that as it may, I mean, NBFCs have anyways run a goodish bit. Are they in your portfolio? And then, of course, public sector banks, where there may be a new beginning.
Yeah. So we are positive on financials in general, okay, across all the three categories which you mentioned. Now, our bigger overweights are still on the private sector banking side. Okay, so that's the sector where we have our biggest overweights. NBFCs we continue to like. We have buys on a lot of them. Now, again, they are different businesses, so you really can't put them under one category, but by and large, we are positive on them. Okay, public sector banks, we are still quite selective. Okay, I think one has to keep in mind that, yes, valuations are what they are, okay, and to that extent there is an argument. But having said that, one has to keep in mind that over a medium term, how market shares are going to shift, etc. And when you're taking a 2-3 year view, I think you really need to bake in all of that. And which is where our comfort is more on private banks and to some extent NBFCs and then public sector banks in that order.
Surendra, what on the consumers? Because post the demand effect, we've seen a lot of stocks coming back. Lever HUL is at an all-time high. ITC is pulled back off late. We've got HUL management talking at the conference today as one of the keynote speakers. Broadly, what's the view on the consumers? I'm asking this because many of the consumer stocks are trading at pretty high multiples. So in that context, how are you placed on the consumer names?
So consumer, like it's a great story in terms of the opportunity, penetration, etc. But as you rightly pointed out, that valuations are on the higher side. So consumer staples is still one of the underweight sectors for us. Okay, so we continue to be underweight. We have been underweight on that sector for a while. And what we are trying to do is play that the same theme a little differently, right? So you have, say, some consumer electrical stocks, right, which are also a play on consumer who really are not in the staples category. So those kind of sectors we have overweight. Media, we could play it through some media stocks, you could play it through some auto stocks. So there are different categories which are also a play on consumer. So we are trying to play it through that rather than playing it through staples where valuations, in our view, don't really leave too much upside on the table.
Probably that explains the kind of stocks you have in your mid-cap portfolio, model portfolio as well, the likes of Imami, Dish TV. I know you can't talk on individual stocks, but probably that explains that you're trying to play the consumer names through, you know, these smaller names, which probably still are attractive from valuation point of view.
Yeah. So I think there are a couple of things here. One is obviously the valuation point, which you rightly mentioned. Then secondly, when you're looking at a sector, you also look at stocks where there could be an opportunity because of some of the things that the companies are doing, right? Somebody might be really increasing their distribution reach, right? And that may be like a more of a tailwind because of internal reasons rather than market reasons.
Okay.
So you always look for those kind of opportunities, which is what would explain some of the stocks in our model portfolio.
So we have to wind up the conversation. We have to get on to technical strategies. Thank you very much for joining us. And I know you two have to run to shepherd your guests into the audience. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you,
Nimesh as well. And of course, we expect you to